tonight, folks, is Barry Chambers. He's our first guest, is Philip Nelson via Skype. Philip, do you hear me?
Yes, sir. Sure do. Loud and clear.
We overcame the worst. I'm going to let you do more talking than normally I would have been a lively host. But, oh, gosh. Look, last time we were on, people liked you, by the way. But the issue of Jack Ruby, that's my little crowd in this universe, okay? He, of course, managed to get me to the hospital and shoot. And, whoops, Lee Harvey Oswald. All right, who was Jack Ruby, and how did he get through, and what was the Carousel Club, and, you know, the works?
Okay, well, we can, I guess, start back in around 1947, when he was known to such people as Jack Valenti and Lyndon Johnson. As a matter of fact, Lyndon Johnson had asked Richard Nixon to hire him as a consultant or an investigator for
now, I may be missing something. Who? Not Jack Ruby. He ran a strip joint.
But no, back in before he ran the strip joint, I'm going back several years. I'm going back about 13 or 16 years there. Back when he was from Chicago and his name was Rubenstein and all that. That I'm just going back. You asked me to describe who he was. I'm just going back a little further than 1963. If you want me to jump to 1963, I can do that too.
Let's keep it relevant. And by the way, I'm doing this under severe duress, technical duress. No, I want to know who Ruby. It never made sense to me, by the way. It never made sense how he got through with a loaded gun to shoot Lee Harvey Oswald. That security?
Well, let me just say this about him. He was well connected to a lot of mafioso, starting with Chicago, the Chicago mob, San Giancana and so forth, and Johnny Roselli. He was also connected to through Bobby Baker in Washington to Ed Levinson, Benjamin Siegelbaum, Clifford Jones, Fred Black, Mickey Weiner, and Irving Davidson, all of whom were also connected to the mob in one way or another. And back down through in Texas, he was also buddies with Joseph Civello as the mafia leader of Dallas. Both Joe Campisi and the Civello were deputies of Carlos Marcello. The New Orleans mob boss. Why would they want to kill Lee Harvey Oswald? Because he was ordered to. He was ordered to do that, through some of these mob figures that I'm trying to explain, because he was given the order to do that. He had been related. And by the way, he had been through a lot of preparation work all through 1963. He had been audited by the IRS. This is one of Lyndon Johnson's, by the way, one of his favorite ways to threaten people and force people to do things. And he used to say that, you know, if you didn't cooperate with him, he would basically sick the commissioner of the IRS on you, or the head of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, and just make your life miserable. So that's the kind of thing that was going on all through 1963. Then suddenly, in the middle of November, just a couple of weeks before JFK went to Dallas, he suddenly comes into a lot of money. He had gone from a position of owing the IRS a total of about $40,000 in back federal taxes after having been audited, you know, to having suddenly a lot of money. And in fact, just 3 hours before the assassination, Ruby visited his bank and talked to an official there who later stated that Ruby made a deposit of $7,000 in large bills.
Yes,
and when he was arrested, he had $3,000 more. So he had suddenly he had $10,000 that, you know, he was carrying around and putting in the bank and so on. So he was paid to be there and perform his job. And one of the things that he was expected to do is if Oswald was not shot by the police when he was arrested, then he would have to take care of it. And he was connected, by the way, to Oswald. A lot of people have come forth over the years and stated that the two of them knew each other, that Oswald used to come into the club, the Carousel Club. All of that was...
He liked strippers?
I'm sorry? Did
Oswald like strippers on top of everything else? He liked strippers?
Well, I don't know what he was doing there, but I assume that he must have liked strippers or the connections that he was ordered to become involved with for some reason. I'm not making this up. A lot of people, as a matter of fact, there was even a news story.
It's just a very weird story. Let's see if we can put reality into it somehow.
Okay, let me just quote you from a news broadcast on the radio station WFAA. This is just after the assassination. The news director, Bob Walker, says on the radio broadcast, quote, "We just learned from City Hall, from a very authoritative source, that police are working on the assumption that there indeed is a connection between Jack Ruby and Lee Oswald, and that in some manner of speaking, Oswald's murder was to shut him up." Also, I'm sorry?
It did do that.
Okay. May I just go on here? He went on to say that they have said that they will not release in the immediate future at all any of the information the FBI has gathered, which lead them to believe so strongly that Oswald had assassinated the president. But the police and investigation now is working on the assumption that there is a definite connection between Lee Oswald and Jack Ruby, and the successful attempt on Oswald's life was an attempt to shut him up. This word from a reliable source at City Hall. So suddenly this is broadcast, and then after, this is right after Oswald is shot, and then it just went away, because obviously someone didn't like the fact that they were talking about such things. But there had been
Now let's get this. So one of the minor characters, but he played a major role, was Jack Ruby. Listen, he was dead within 2 years of a mysterious cancer, but he opened his mouth a few times and said, "If I talk, the government falls." There's something with the Ruby story that deserves wider exposure.
Well, you mean the fact that he did die of cancer and that there were efforts being made at that time, just before the assassination and during that whole period, to develop a vaccine down in New Orleans, which was described in, you know, great detail by Ed Haslam in his book, Dr. Mary's Monkey. That's an entire book that is devoted to just that subject.
I'm not familiar with that side. Look, for us simpletons, go to New Orleans, but you got to tie it together now.
Well, that's an entire book that he wrote, so I'm just going to try to summarize it. But what was going on in New Orleans is that there was a clinic there named the Ochsner Clinic, and there was a right-wing, John Birch type guy running that clinic, named Dr. Alton Ochsner, and he brought in a number of people in that summer of 1963 for the very purpose of developing a cancerous causing vaccine. And among those people were Lee Harvey Oswald.
I know it's going to side in New Orleans. That, by the way, that also has never been properly explained. Despite the movie, it was not explained well. What was he doing?
Well, it was explained in that book I just told you about. So you have to, you know.
There was a whole movie. I mean, it's.
Are you talking about the movie JFK?
Harrison stuff. New Orleans played a major role here. You're saying it developed the cancer that killed Ruby.
I'm saying that they were developing such a vaccination, or if you want to call it that, something that they could inject into someone and kill them. Yes, that's precisely what I'm saying. And it's all explained in that book. I was trying to just summarize it there, but I didn't get too far.
No, it's important. Again, what we were told and the background are pretty well not the same.
Was there a question there?
Well, I would think there'd be a response there. Look, Lee Harvey Oswald was in New Orleans. We see him holding the rifle in New Orleans. You're bringing New Orleans back.
And no, he was not holding the rifle in New Orleans. He was. There was a picture that was of really someone else, and the picture was fabricated to appear that Oswald was holding that rifle, but that was in Dallas. It wasn't New Orleans.
I know the shadow was not the face of Lee Harvey created a shadow that the rest of the body didn't share. I know this side. All right, let's do our best. Go to it, Philip.
Okay. Well, back to New Orleans. I'll start there because I never did finish what I was going to explain there, but this clinic that Dr. Ochsner put together a whole crew, and that crew included Lee Harvey Oswald. It included Judith Berry Baker, according to her and according to Ed Haslam. It included David Ferry and others.
Homosexual. All right, I'm sorry. You're bringing up memories that I have. I'm sorry. Away you go.
Well, the book describes in excruciating detail how that whole operation was run, and it was run basically a lady who's a doctor, Dr. Mary Sherman, was brought in to supervise and manage the development of that vaccination. I keep calling it a vaccination. I'm not sure what else it would be called, but it wasn't to prevent disease. It was designed to cause disease, cause cancer, and a quickly developing type of cancer at that. And anyway, they had continued doing this all through that summer, and then towards the end of the summer, things started falling apart because some of the participants, including Judith, decided, according to her, she decided that she wanted no part of it anymore because they were going to test that on a live subject. Now, the subject was someone who was not only a Cuban, but he was the same size, the weight, height of Fidel Castro. And the idea was that if it worked on him, then it could be counted on to also kill Fidel Castro. Well, the person who was chosen was a prisoner, and he was, as I recall, he was on death row. That is, he was a prisoner. He was going to be executed anyway. But there was some resistance to pursuing that. And anyway, some things happened in New Orleans which broke up this little affair, and at least for some of the people there. And one of the results was that Judith was kind of fired, and then right after that, so was Lee Oswald. And anyway, Lee Oswald
fired
then goes
from what? I'm sorry. Before we all get too lost, what was he fired from?
Well, from both of his jobs that he had in New Orleans, this program that they were working on to develop the vaccine, as well as his job at the coffee company, Riley Coffee. And all I'm doing now, Barry, is to try to summarize a rather long book into a few words.
It really is an incredible story, but Jack Ruby somewhere fit in this, and he's been shoved aside as a stripper club who got mad one day, and I and several of my readers want you to sort that out. No one has the...
That's what I started to try to do back in Dallas when I was talking about what was going on with Jack Ruby in Dallas all during 1963, where he was being audited and hounded to death by a lot of people, and he was in constant communication also with some of his mobster friends. As I said before, mobsters in Chicago, in Las Vegas, in New Orleans, in Dallas, and basically suddenly he comes into a lot of money. And the reason he came into a lot of money is speculation, of course, but the one possibility was that he was now being paid off to do what he was going to have to do one way or the other. And that was...
Did he expect to be caught? I mean, is there any other conclusion? What would he use the money for except for a lawyer?
Well, he wasn't expecting to be caught, because the idea was that Oswald was supposed to be shot by the police when he was being arrested. Well, that did not happen, as you know. He was arrested in the theater there in Oak Cliff, and the result was he was taken downtown, and they tried to interview him and book him, but that wasn't going to work out.
A cop was shot at the theater. They said by Oswald, that was also a very messy, messy story. Oh, gosh. Is there something here that we should know? Philip?
Yes?
Is there something we should know about the arrest at the theater?
Well, that the arrest at the theater, there was a lot to talk about that also, but the fact is, he actually tried to pull a gun, and it misfired because it was a junk gun, and the police simply took the gun away from him and did not shoot him. And no one really can explain that. I can't. I don't know why they didn't shoot him, but that was supposed to be part of the plan. But the real plan, I believe, was that he was supposed to have been shot back down at the Texas School Book Depository. So maybe the people or the policemen who were out there weren't aware of that, or what, for whatever reason, they didn't shoot him. It's just a matter of history.
So this is unraveling.
Ruby, the point of all this, I believe, is that Ruby was the fail-safe. He was the one who would take care of things if anything went wrong and Oswald did not get killed as he was being arrested. And so he did what he had to do. He was given a job that he could not refuse. And if he had tried to refuse it, he knew that his days were numbered anyway. So he had to go through with it on the promise, it is believed, that things would work out for him, that he would get off, because after all, he was sort of a hero, and at least that's what he was told, and that he would be acquitted on the basis that he shot the assassin of the president.
Assassin, right. He didn't believe that. You're not allowed to go and shoot an assassin. That's still murder.
No. Well, I no one really knows, Barry, exactly what he was told and what his motives were, but I think it's safe to speculate, at least, that something along those lines is what happened. The fact of the matter is, and this has been documented over and over by a lot of people from Johnson's own longtime mistress, Madeline Brown, said that there was a direct link between Jack Ruby and Oswald. John Currington, H.L. Hunt's assistant, admitted that he had seen Ruby and Oswald and George de Warenshield and H.L. Hunt together on various occasions. Peter Dale Scott, you know him, the professor from Berkeley, stated that far from being meager and easily enumerated, so manifold as to defy enumeration, Ruby was in contact up to the very hours before the assassination with establishment figures who in turn interfaced with the intelligence mob connection. I could name a bunch of more names if you want me to, but I'm not sure they would clarify the point.
Look, Philip, first thing is, I know you because I enjoyed your book, LBJ, The Mastermind of JFK Assassination. You have something new in Colossus. Plug yourself like crazy before the break.
Well, okay. My latest book is called LBJ, From Mastermind to the Colossus, and it's all about the after the assassination, after Johnson becomes president, and some of the additional depraved things that he did in those years as president. I'm sorry?
How do we get it?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, well, it's available in bookstores and Amazon and Books A Million and Barnes and Noble, and it lists for $24.95, but you can get it through Amazon, I believe, for about $19.
I hate to do this to you, spell your name. If people want it, make it, available.
Well, my name is Philip Nelson. Philip with two L's, Nelson, N-E-L-S-O-N, and the book again is LBJ, From Mastermind to the Colossus, C-O-L-O-S-S-U-S, Colossus.
Look, folks, I'm not sure, I have technical difficulties, but I hear a great interview, but also a very confusing one. When we get back after the break, I'll plug me for a second, but then I hate to say my kinder, my family, in some way was Ruby. He was the Jew involved in this. And my people want to know, how was he involved in this assassination? We know he was. We just don't know how. Philip?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know. I thought we were breaking.
It was, okay, leave it at this. I have my own personal reasons that I really want to speak to you. I should have put you on for 2 hours. But nonetheless, as best you can, help us. Tell us who this Jack Ruby was. All right, you say it, mob ties. So the mob killed Kennedy? I mean, what does that imply that he had mob ties? In 3 minutes, we're going to find out, folks. We've got lots of other stuff as well. We'll be back with Philip Nelson. This is Barry King.
You're listening to FirstAmendmentRadio.com worldwide. Freedom is never free. We need your support today at FirstAmendmentRadio.com.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening. Since the beginning of time, kings have sought it, nations have fought for it, it has been traded, it has been borrowed, it has been purchased. It has been stolen. There's a reason for it. To secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity. Invest with the security of gold and silver. Call Discount Gold and Silver Trading at 1-800-375-4188 or visit discountgoldandsilvertrading.net. Listen to Financial Survival with your host, Melody Cedarstrom, right here on FirstAmendmentRadio.com at 4 p.m. Eastern or 1 p.m. Pacific Time. Visit discountgoldandsilvertrading.net or call Discount Gold and Silver Trading at 1-800-375-4188. Toll free, 1-800-375-4188.
Hiya, folks. This is Barry Chalmers, and don't let anyone fool you. Somebody doesn't want this show on the air, but I've got Skype and I've got phone, so we're getting it. And I've got a very honored guest in Philip Nelson. Look, you get all my books at lulu.com, www.lulu.com. Just write in my last name, Chamish, Chamish. And thanks to David Samarin, I still have a website, www.barrychamish.com. Now, Philip, one way or another, let's just summarize why did Ruby die in a prison? Why would he break through and the Dallas police station and shoot Oswald? Who gave him the order? What's going on here?
Okay, well, I can say that this about that, which is that Johnny Roselli, years later, and I'm talking about in 1976, he would start talking and reveal to the columnist Jack Anderson that Jack Ruby, quote, was one of our boys and had been ordered to kill Oswald. Shortly after this, his discussion with Jack Anderson, and just after he testified on the first day in closed session to the Church Committee of Congress, Roselli was murdered, and his body was found cut into pieces and stuffed in an oil drum that floated to the surface in a Florida intercoastal waterway. Well, so there you have someone from the mob admitting exactly what happened.
What was that exactly? Right. He was a mobster. What do we know about him? He liked dogs. He had a stripper friend who... Do you know her name? I recall her. She opened her mouth, his stripper friend from the club.
Was it Candy Bar?
Yeah, that's her. That's her.
Yeah.
What well, did she say? How did she get into the headlines?
Well, you know, one of the things, and there were a number of strippers that he became friends with. That was one of them. And I think it was her that who, you know, Gerald Posner wrote a book, not the closed, the case closed book about the JFK assassination, but another book he wrote about the Martin Luther King assassination. And in that book, he revealed that I think it was Candy Bar who admitted that she had been in, adult movies, and actually when she was still underage. In other words, child porn type movies with Jack Ruby and Jack Valenti.
Together?
No, not in the movies, but they were the business people behind this little enterprise, putting together these child porn movies. And that was one of the other ways that they were kind of acting out together. And here, that's another connection between Jack Ruby to Jack Valenti, and then back around to Lyndon Johnson, Bobby Baker, that whole bunch.
Oh, gosh, this story is not going to go away easily.
Well, that's something that's in the book, of all places. Gerald Posner, who was no friend to conspiracy theorists, as you know,
yep.
somehow put that in his book, and that basically gave it some amount of, credence. In an indirect way, but now Valenti denied that when he was still alive to Posner, so it didn't go very far. But for Posner to go ahead and put in that book, suggests that there might have been something to it.
You know, let's take a short break, and we are going to go on to the Valenti story in 1 second, folks. Next week you get a repeat. It's Christmas. Not only is nobody going to be listening, you're going to be celebrating Christmas. And you're going to hear the Jerome Corsi, Eliza Bass-Menachem interview of this week, next week. Warning, I get a Christmas break. All right, now we go on to Jack Valenti. Why was he anointed Mr. Hollywood? Now, what you say is he stopped projects. Let's do our best here.
Okay. Well, he was appointed there, and it was something that Lyndon Johnson, through his good buddy Lou Wasserman, who was Mr. Hollywood in those days, probably the most powerful of the Hollywood moguls. Johnson goes to Wasserman and gets him to agree to appoint Jack Valenti to be head of the Motion Picture Association out there. And in that capacity, he would reign. He sort of became Mr. Hollywood, as everyone knows. I mean, he was always pictured in the news with the Hollywood stars and so forth. And basically, he came forward on a number of occasions to basically control, to basically censor what was going to be telecast or...
Any chance do you have examples?
Yes, I do. As a matter of fact, the most widely known of the examples occurred in 2003 when he was still out there. This is 40 years later, about 43 years later. And he was still in charge of Hollywood. And basically, after the Men Who Killed Kennedy series, the last three episodes of that series, called The Smoking Guns, and another was called The Love Affair, and that had Judith Barry Baker in it as the primary subject. And then the last one was episode 9, The Guilty Man, and that basically had a lot of people pointing the finger of suspicion at Lyndon B. Johnson as being the guy behind the whole plot. Well, that didn't work. I mean, that didn't settle too well with
JFK
Mr.
was
Hollywood.
Made. I know Valenti was dead by then, but there was a movie. It was a commercial success called JFK, where one side of this does come out pretty clearly. The Garrison side.
Yeah, that's right. That was something that did make it out, but it wasn't. You see, Valenti's object out there was not to just stop every movie of JFK or whatever. It was to protect the legacy of Lyndon Johnson. That was his master right there. And even though Johnson had been dead for about 40 years at that point, well, at least 30 years, from 1973 on to 2003 was, what was that, 30 years. Johnson had been dead all that time, but Bill, between Jack Valenti and Bill Moyers, the two of them, and along with them was Lady Bird, who is also still alive, Jerry Ford, ex-president, and Jimmy Carter. They all came out to the History Channel and forced them to withdraw that movie from ever being broadcast again. Now, fortunately, it's still available for people to see, but it can't be broadcast, and that is the problem. I mean, unless you know about it, unless you research it and you go there to get a copy or to watch it on YouTube, well, you'll never know about it because it's not being broadcast anymore. And that was one of his final acts to protect the legacy of Lyndon Johnson. But there was something that went on back in 1968 that was even as interesting and dramatic as that.
That
involved Lyndon Johnson's cousin. Well, it's a second cousin. J. Burt Peck was his name. And in 1968, he did a couple of things that greatly embarrassed Lyndon Johnson. And the problem with embarrassing Lyndon Johnson is that many people who did this wound up dead, and so did Mr. Peck. Just a few months later, he was shot in his own house by an intruder. And however, it was ruled a suicide, as many of these murders were. This was not unusual in that case. But it started.
You wrote me that he was used as a stand-in whenever LBJ had
right,
to be elsewhere.
That's what I was. That's
what
exactly
does that mean?
That is exactly right, and that's how it all started, because that's how he embarrassed Johnson. There were articles in two magazines, both Time and Newsweek, in early August, the first week of August of 1968. These magazines came out with little stories in there about this fellow, J. Burt Peck, the cousin of Johnson, who announced that he had been a double. So that is, he was known to have stood in for Johnson on a number of occasions when Johnson wanted his presence known to have existed, even though he needed to be someplace else at that point in time. And one such incident, many researchers have concluded, was on the evening before the assassination of JFK, on November the 21st, 1963. That evening, Johnson, after having flown up from Houston with JFK in that evening, he wound up having his cousin, J. Burt Peck, stand in for him and appear at the Fort Worth Hotel in the dining room, and so that people would see him and report that he was seen there, even though he didn't really, there was no record of him ever speaking to anybody there.
He looked so much like Johnson.
He looked exactly like Johnson, and his voice sounded exactly like Johnson. So there he was. He was seen there. And however, at that very time, Johnson was over at Clint Murchison's estate, his mansion over there, at the famous meeting that he was called to be at to give the final nod on going forward with the assassination, with many other people there in attendance. So that's been written about, you know, by a number of people, including myself.
Well, certainly your Colossus book is written about. You sent me the link.
Yeah, the mastermind. Yeah, and now this. In addition to those two magazine articles, he also appeared on in this movie. That's what these articles were about. The fact that he was appearing in a 1968 movie starring Dean Martin, Elkie Summer, and Sharon Tate. And the movie was called The Wrecking Crew. Now, you can see that.
What was it called?
The Wrecking Crew. And you can watch that on I believe... it's called dailymotion.com. And you just put in The Wrecking Crew or Dean Martin and so forth, and you watch this. It's about an hour and a half, almost 2-hour movie. And
oh, gosh. No, you're not going to. I'm going
to. No, you don't have to. But I'm saying if you want to. You don't.
What was surely Elkie Summer didn't understand she was part of this plot.
Oh, no. All I'm saying is that this is how he embarrassed the president, and why he later got killed, because it embarrassed Johnson to have that as part of a permanent record for people to actually see that Johnson had this look-alike cousin who sounded like him and he looked like him, and in fact, he was known as a LBJ stand-in. And that's exactly what that movie showed. Well, that's why his buddy Jack Valente came out of the woodwork there and changed that movie so that some of the scenes were revised, and the credits were adjusted so that J. Burt Peck was no longer in it as a credit. And in fact, at first, what he did was he changed his name from Peck to Pick, P-I-C-K. And also deleted one of the scenes where this fellow appeared, and the other one, which had panned around to show him from the back and then panned around to the front, that pan around was deleted, because so all you could see was him from the back. Okay.
So you're saying he went to all this trouble
to change the record so that people would not know that he had this guy as a look-alike stand-in. And furthermore, he also, this guy, J. Burt Peck, appeared on the Johnny Carson show. And that was reported in his obituary when he was killed just a few months later in his house by a what I call the murderous mortician, John Liggett, who then a few years later decided that he had to not only have killed him, J. Burt Peck, but now he had to kill his wife because she knew too much, and he thought he had killed her. He had attacked her and also set her on fire. He thought she was already dead, and he set a fire to burn up the evidence. And the problem is, she wasn't dead. So she came to and ran out of the burning house and went to the next door's neighbor and called the police. The police came out, and then they found this guy, John Liggett, arrested him.
He's the mortician.
Yeah. Well,
all right, what was his role? What did he conclude the killing was? I assume he covered that up.
Well, that's what he was trying to do. He was trying to cover it up. He was trying to cover up a murder that he had not completed, because the woman was not dead. And as a result, it got him thrown in jail. And some months later, after his lawyer came forward and ordered him not to talk to anybody, at some point he was then they were going to move him from the jail to a courtroom, and someone snuck him the keys to his handcuffs, and he got himself free and tried to run away.
And he was shot in the back.
He was shot in the back by a deputy. Yeah. And so, yeah, he was murdered by the deputy. So the whole thing is just, you know, stinks to high heaven. It's very involved.
Is it more
I'm sorry that it's so involved. It does get complicated. Yep, you're right. Sorry about
Look,
that.
Look, you believe that LBJ was the mastermind of all of this. For some reason, you wrote me that it was not Alan Dulles. That's Corsi's best. Without getting mixed up, Jerome Corsi swears that Alan Dulles got the Nazis, tens of thousands of them, freedom in America. But you're saying LBJ was the mastermind. I don't even know why you think Alan Dulles was. Explain that whole thing. It's
okay. I believe that it had to be Johnson. Now, I'm not saying that Alan Dulles wasn't involved. Certainly he was. There's no question about that. But the question of who was more powerful, was it Alan Dulles or was it Lyndon Johnson? And that's the key to answering that question, because it took someone of enormous power to pull it off. And a man who uniquely could guarantee to everyone who was a participant that they would get off, that they would not be arrested. And that had to be Johnson, because he was the president. And Alan Dulles, at that point in time, was an unemployed ex-spy.
All right, this is 68, when Johnson was, in fact, president. This is what he goes to the office and wastes his time doing?
We're talking about 1963. It was
Then it's different. Then he was vice president.
He was vice president, but he suddenly became president, right?
Oh, yes, he did.
When JFK was killed, then suddenly he was killed, and Johnson became president. Now, it does not follow that the authority residing within a structure that Alan Dulles was not even involved with anymore, not officially, and he didn't have an office there. So the question is, you know, are we to infer in that scenario, that the Dulles scenario, that he issued his deadly orders as an enigmatic but secret CEO through an amorphous group of anonymous men at the helm of an invisible government?
Including the mob, if I'm following you right.
Oh, yeah, there was some mob involvement. We just talked about Jack Ruby, and that was that.
Yeah.
There was, obviously, CIA was in charge of the details. However, the CIA and Alan Dulles had nothing to do with that motorcade. Or the Dallas police setting up the right people within the Dallas police and judicial structure, and the whole thing in Dallas, they had nothing to do with that. It had to be, and they had nothing to do with the makeup of that motorcade.
Hit, or the except for one problem is New Orleans. That's where it veered a bit from Dallas. You're saying
it was
to test a cancer, well, anti-vaccine, I suppose. That's where New Orleans fit into this?
New Orleans was simply a part of an extension from Dallas that was the place where they did a lot of setting up of Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yep.
That's all New Orleans.
It's bothered me for a long time, that side issue. Look, I'm going to... if I'm right, tell me I'm right that Jack Ruby and Jack Valenti were promoters of porn. And they, well, at least well, Ruby, shot Oswald. These were pornographers.
Well, it was a sideline business, as I explained.
Not everyone as a sideline. Like, all right, fair enough.
Well, let me just go back to that other point, and because the missing element, I think, in that business of Alan Dulles, the Alan Dulles scenario, if we can call it that, was that if there was something missing there, and that was a single driving force. It is, and I believe it was it had to have existed within a very powerful source, a force that was so powerful that it could only emanate from the one man who could guarantee complete protection to the key people to be recruited. It had to be so powerful that it could only exist through a man that forceful, so
Hoover
formidable.
At the FBI.
Even Robert Kennedy admitted Johnson was the most formidable man he had ever met, that he could control multiple departments and agencies, law enforcement, intelligence, judicial, investigative. Hoover was only one of those, by the way. On the federal, on the state of Texas, on the city of Dallas levels, all of those levels and all of those kinds of departments, only one man was such a powerful driving force, and therefore axiomatically could it only have been also from a man who was manic by nature. There was nobody more manic than Lyndon Johnson. It sure as hell wasn't Alan Dulles. He was
a tweed-coated,
pipe-smoking introvert, you know, from Princeton. So tell me about how he was a manic. He wasn't. It could only have been given life by the man having a lifetime obsession to become president of the United States. That force had to have sprung from a man driven by hunger for greater power. And as Robert Caro once described Lyndon Johnson's lust for power, quote, a hunger so fierce and so consuming that no consideration of morality or ethics, no cost to himself or to anyone else could stand before it. The best candidate for the driving force was one whose favorite expression was power is where power goes, and whose entire career was based upon the inherent premise of that very expression.
I got to get this in, or people aren't going to buy your book, and I think they should. I read LBJ, The Mastermind. It was a great book. You got to tell people how to get this book. And by the way, we're archived for a week at libertyarchives.com if you missed anything. And one more time, let's get this book sold a bit. Oh, quick. We're on with Larry Reitman in 7 minutes.
Okay, well, the first book, as you just said, LBJ, The Mastermind of the JFK Assassination, explains in considerable detail on about 600 pages about why I believe that he was the mastermind.
We have like 10 seconds. Where can people get it?
Amazon, Books a Million, Barnes & Noble, your favorite little bookstore, Powell's in Portland,
Fantastic.
Oregon, out there.
Philip, under tremendous technical duress, you were great. Thank you. I should have had you on for both hours. Folks, we'll be back in 7 with Larry Wright. This is Gary Chambers.
Gold and silver is tremendously undervalued. Global demand vastly exceeds mined supply by more than 60% annually. There is little in the financial world more certain than a coming explosion in the prices of gold and silver. The U.S. dollar continues to lose value and respect as the world's reserve currency. Our nation faces challenges on many fronts, and a day doesn't pass without another economist bringing forth warnings of impending economic calamity. There has never been a better time than right now to acquire physical gold and silver. Discount Gold and Silver Trading was founded on the principles of truth and honesty. We believe in providing a quality product, quality service, and most importantly, competitive pricing. We provide all forms of precious metals, including American gold, silver, platinum, and rare investment and circulated coins. Silver bars, rounds, and 90% silver bags are on hand for the silver investor. Gold self-directed IRAs are available. Call Discount Gold and Silver Trading at 1-800-375-4188. Toll free, that's 1-800-375-4188. Years ahead of the dominant media, FirstAmendmentRadio.com and FirstAmendmentRadio.net.